call you back to your seats. As we go ahead and get started. If you are still grabbing coffee, feel free as we kind of just get started with service. We're going to pray and then open up, but you are more than welcome to finish grabbing coffee or at any point during service. Also, parents, I know we've got kids in the room this morning, and if your kid needs a place to just kind of like get out the, you know, the antsiness of sitting down, we've got some spaces around the room. I just want you to know it is not a bother at all if at some point during service you need to get up and take a walk. Doesn't bother me. It won't bother the people who are up here sharing. We're going to just jump in actually today and start off by praying. And so I want to invite you just to join me in a moment of prayer. So would you pray with me today? Just asking that God would speak to us this morning. Lord, we just come to you just like we started off service, trying to bring our attention to you and asking you, God, that you would speak this morning. Because, Lord, what we need isn't a bunch of other voices just to fill our mind and our heart, but, Lord, what we need more than anything is your voice to speak to us, Lord, in such a way that we leave differently because we encountered you today. And so we just take a minute here, Lord, just to ask you that you would speak to us in some way that we need to hear. And now I just want to invite you, in the quietness of your own heart and mind, just to take 20 seconds or so and just ask God to speak to you today in some way that you need to hear. Kids, if you're in the room, this can just be really as simple as, God, would you talk to me today? God, I want to hear from you. So just go ahead and take a couple moments here and just do that in your own head and heart, and then I'll close this out. Lord, we invite you to speak. Lord, we want to give you our attention today and pray in return that you just give us your heart and you move our feet so we could be good news, Lord, vessels for the world around us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, one of the great joys that I have is being an aunt to a 15-month-old little boy named Milo. I'm going to show you a video of him here in just a second. For a while, he's been in this phase where he will like clap in response to almost anything that seems positive or that we tell him is positive, whether that's like a really great car that drives by or a successful diaper change or a word said right, you know, whatever it is. And he's learned that largely through his mom and dad and then aunts like myself, grandma, grandpa, and teachers and all that who have showed him and taught him that the proper response to something good is celebration. Kids in the room, can you clap? There you go. Yeah. All right. Good job. Some kids at heart who did it as well. Here's a video of him at the splash pad yesterday.
All right. Can I clap? Good job. Yay.
Wow. So rather than like clapping, now he started to move to like a car goes by, it's like, wow. Blocks fall down, wow. So here's another video of.
Oh, okay, here we go. Ready?
Can you say wow? Wow. Wow. Thank you, all of the middle school and high school students. You know, as kids, we learn celebration. And then as we get to be, you know, maybe teenagers, but especially adults, it seems that we begin to unlearn celebration. Celebration starts to feel like a frivolous thing or something that is disconnected from the difficulties of the world, or it starts to feel like something that's just for kids. You know, we stop to have birthday parties as you get older, like, I don't need to celebrate, it's just another year, right? Like, celebration just starts to feel like it's something that belongs to our childhood. But here's the thing, is celebration is not inherently childish. Celebration is actually inherently biblical. Celebration is a theme whose thread you can trace from the beginning of the biblical story to the very end. So on the first couple pages of your Bible, God creates the world and everything in it, and then after 6 days, as he finishes it, and it says he pauses to look at what he's made and then to recognize this is good. And then he takes a day to stop and just to enjoy everything that he's made. In short, he takes a day to celebrate. Fast forward a little bit in the book of Exodus, after he leads his people out of Egypt, out of their slavery, he begins to give them laws and guidelines for how to live in right relationship with him and with other people. And one of the commands that he gives them is actually to celebrate 3 times a year. No joke. Exodus 23:14, 3 times a year, you are to celebrate a festival to me. Imagine a command to celebrate. You must celebrate. Imagine next time you want to blow back past your birthday, someone's like, you must celebrate. 3 times a year. Fast forward to Jesus on the earthly scene, and his first miracle is not walking on water or raising the dead or healing the sick, though all of these things are and would have been wonderful. His first miracle is actually turning water into wine at a wedding celebration. Fast forward to the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, and the final, one of the final things that he does with his disciples is sit around with them, share a meal at something called the Passover celebration. Fast forward to the last couple pages of your Bible, and we get this vision of what eternity is going to look like, and it's a celebration. Revelation 19, verses 6 and 7, it says, "Then I heard again what sounded like the shout." Kids, can you shout? Yeah! Yeah! "Of a vast crowd, or the roar of mighty ocean waves, or the crash of loud thunder." I'm not going to ask us to crash down, because that's too easy for kids to crash into anything nowadays. "They were shouting, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, because the wedding celebration of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready.'" See, celebration is not inherently childish. It is inherently biblical, and it's one of the things that we tend to unlearn as adults, and it's one of the things that we need to relearn as children of God. But how often do you, or do I, stop, pause, notice, and name the ways that God has been good in our lives, the ways that he has been faithful? And so what we're going to do today is not just talk about that. We're actually going to do that. We're going to practice that. So we've got 4 people who are going to be giving you guys just a little bit of a taste of the ways that they've seen God this summer. They're going to invite you in to celebrate with them how they've seen God be good and faithful this summer, particularly through some of our summer camps and mission trips. And so would you all welcome up with me those who are going to be sharing today? And if you're sharing, would you make your way on up here? This is where you practice the clapping, everybody. Yeah. All right, and would you mind grabbing, actually, Toby, would you mind grabbing that mic right there? Perfect, perfect. All right, you guys can take a seat in the order that you're gonna be sharing, but all of the people who are gonna be sharing today, all of the testimonies are either from or about the next generation, okay? So we have someone from kind of preschool, kids, preschool ministry who volunteered this summer, kids ministry, our kids ministry director, youth and college students. If you did not know, the name of this service is Vessel, but the name of the broader church the Vessel's a part of is University Carillon. And that is because we are literally situated right between the University of Central Florida and behind us a collection of neighborhoods called Carillon, in which Carillon Elementary and Hagerty High are directly situated. And so if you are part of this church, like, you are going to be part of a church that is often going to give time, resources, energy, and sometimes the microphone to kids, youth, and college students, because here our location is directly tied to our mission. We are a church that is going to invest in preschool all the way up through college students and beyond, of course, but we have a really unique call on our hearts at this church to be investing in that next generation. And so that's some of what we want to invite you into today, because some of you, many of you, have not been part of a lot of the things that they've gotten to see this summer. And so we're going to take a few minutes, they're going to take a few minutes each, to just invite you, really, to celebrate with them how they have seen God move. And so each of you all have a couple minutes to just invite these lovely people here into the ways that you've seen God move. And so we're going to start off, we've got Josh here, who is part of our Prodigal College Ministry and was also on our recent trip. Yep. Good job. Practicing the clapping. I like it. You can say wow at some point if it's appropriate during a testimony. Wow. Okay. All right. Good job. So that was weirder than I expected. And then we've got Janet, who volunteered at some of our preschool camps this summer. We have Toby, aka Tabasco, aka Brandon, who is part of our Epic Youth Ministry and was at a bunch of stuff this summer. And then Jesse, who is our kids ministry and sports director. And so would you all welcome up Josh to share first off here.
Good morning. Like she said, my name is Josh, and I have the privilege to come up here this morning to tell you how God has worked through me this summer, through joining Prodigal and this past mission trip. So growing up, I've been coming to this church for a while. I've been baptized and confirmed here. And as I got older, I started coming here less and less, only on Christmas and Easter. And then last year, God put in my heart to get to know him better. A good friend of mine runs a Bible study group. And he said, why don't you come with me? We meet in the Student Union Center on Wednesdays at 6 o'clock. So every Wednesday I would go there, and I would be part of that Bible study. But there was also another group that met there every Wednesday at 6 o'clock in the Student Union Center. Mm-hmm. And I remember the first time I went there, he like pointed them out to me. He said, you're going to be part of that group one day. And little did I know at that time, that group was Lighthouses that is run by Prodigal. So fast forward a few months, God told me to come back home. I was like, what? He's like, come back to University of Caroline. I'm like, God, there's no way I'm coming to University of Caroline. Now I'm up here talking to you guys, so we know who won that battle. And as I walk in, everyone's just super friendly, like really welcoming. I'm like, wow, this is really sweet. And they hand me a bulletin. And I skim through the bulletin, and I read that there's a group that meets in the Epic building on Tuesday at 7:30. If you guys know it, it's called Prodigal. Shout out. So when I read that, I was like, wow, a college group my age. And God told me to come home. I was like, all right, I'll give it a shot. So Tuesday comes, and I go. And as I walk in, I see that exact people that God told me that I was going to meet one day. I walk in, I see all of them. I'm like, wow, this is exactly where I needed to be. And as the night goes on, I realize, like, wow, everyone's super friendly. They're super sweet. And just amazing people to get to know. And the first time in my life, I felt like I actually like belonged somewhere and like they actually cared about me. And then at the end of the night, God puts into my heart to leave. It's like, all right, you're good to go. Let's leave. So I walk out. I say bye to a few people. I go in my car and I vividly hear God's voice say, Josh, Josh. And I'm like, I'm just confused. I'm like, what? And I hear him say, Josh, give me everything you have to offer. Give me all of you. I remember I'm sitting in that parking lot, in the Epic parking lot. I grab my Bible, and I hear him say it again, Josh, give me all of you. And I pause for a moment. I think. I said, yes, my Lord, I'll give you everything I have to offer. In that moment, he told me, go to everything Prodigal has to offer. So I went to everything. That next Tuesday, I was there. We had a Prodigal beach trip. I was there. I was simply always there. My catchphrase in the group chat was, I'm there. I'm simply just there. And it was just so amazing to see that like a family was just flourishing as I got closer and closer to everyone. I wasn't even in Prodigal for 2 months, and I had the opportunity to join leadership. At that time, Chris was he was getting married, and Prodigal was just had like a month break. So I kept going to this group, but I didn't even know the guy running it. And then the first conversation I had with him, I'm like, hey, Chris, can I join leadership? Some guy I didn't even know was asking to join leadership. And he actually looked at me in the eyes and he was like, Josh, I was going to ask you. So to be given that opportunity and be given to meet everyone is amazing. It's just amazing to grow all the friendships and constantly grow my faith. And I was given the opportunity to go to DR. And that was amazing, too. That was so much fun. We had an opportunity to go evangelize. I met this one lady. She invited us into her house. Super friendly. It caught me off guard. Like, someplace I was told is dangerous, and I can't really communicate that well with people, but the first thing she said was, come inside. I thought that was amazing to witness. Florida people would never, I knock on someone's door, can I come in? No. No. She's already outside. I'm like, let's come on in, come on in. I'm like, okay. And, the amount of faith this woman had was amazing. She knew if we prayed over her dad, he had severe dementia. She just knew if we prayed over him, he would be healed. The amount of faith she had was just so inspiring to witness. And to be put in those situations to grow transformed my perspective on when I come back home. I used to be kind of timid and worried, like, oh, should I talk to that guy? Should I not talk to that guy? But if I was able to do that in DR, with a place that's dangerous and with a place that I don't know where I'm at, I can do that here. So it was amazing to be given all these wonderful opportunities. Thank you, Bart. Thank you, Chris, for taking care of us during this trip. Prodigal fam, I love you guys so much. I only gave God an inch, and he went miles with it. Imagine what God could do if you give him a mile. So thank you for having me up here. I hope you guys have a wonderful Sunday.
Good morning, church family. My name is Janet Vanderwide. It is such an honor to be with you today and share my experience of volunteering within this place. I came here as a UCF student 2 decades ago and just fell in love with all of that this church has to offer. And I helped with the preschoolers this summer in Vacation Bible School and the preschool fun camps. If I met somebody like at the grocery store or anywhere else, I tell everyone I meet about this church and all the awesome things God is doing. If I could only be given one word, I would say intentional. And I want to say Jamie Deeger, she did the most phenomenal job of preparing the preschool fun camp for everything to be memorable and intentional. Can you please pull up the pictures? I'm a visual person, so I want to share. So at preschool fun camp, the children, if you look at all the way on the right, they were immersed in a Bible story every single day. They would walk in this room, and it was transformed, like they went back in time. And for example, if you look in your bulletin, there's a picture of a big blue tent, and it was Jonah. The whale, it had big bulging eyes on it. And she passed around a can of tuna fish you had to smell because it's stinky inside of a whale, right? And stuffed animals everywhere. And it was so amazing. The preschool staff here is the best. I say if there was like some type of group that was like a fan club, I would be the president for sure and the children's ministry. So also, I volunteered in the Vacation Bible School in the snack room, which looked like Costco. We had every single snack there was. And can you imagine being between 2 to 5 years old and walking in and seeing Costco snacks everywhere and being told, you can have anything you want? They were so excited, like the messy pudding cups, all of it. They could have whatever they wanted. But what was memorable to me is I asked, who would like to pray before we eat? And so many of the preschoolers raised their hand. How do you choose? Like, you want to hear all of them, right? There was one particular girl named Amber. I believe she's 4 years old, and she is filled with the Holy Spirit. She would say the Lord's Prayer. She would tell us about how grateful she was for his love. And I was stunned by her faithfulness at such a young age. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and purity. Our church is full of this. I wanted to show you this picture on the left. It's a chalkboard that is out on the playground. There was a girl named Julia, and every single day she would take her piece of chalk and run over there, and she would draw the volunteers in our classroom and her, and it would say, I love you, you're the best, and at the bottom, you can't see it, but it would say, you are so cute, and it would have my name with a backward J and hearts all around it, and I was just overwhelmed by her love and her gratefulness for this church. As a young child, I went to a Vacation Bible School, and I heard about Jesus. And it changed the trajectory of my life. And now it's my mission to give that back. And this church is an amazing place to do that. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way they should go. And when they are older, they will not depart from it. This community is a blessing because we share God's word for all ages, but especially kids. And I want to thank all of you who invested in this summer One day, these kids will know God and they will make him known.
Hi guys, my name is Toby or Tabasco. I've been going to Epic from sixth grade, and now I'm going into my junior year. I've been going to this church for my whole life. I went here for preschool. I went to the Law for Kids ministry. And this summer at Epic, I got to both lead and be a student at a lot of camps. And the one camp where I feel like I felt God the most was Converge. And usually when students are talking about Converge, they talk a lot about Cry Night or Thursday night. But for me, Wednesday night was the most powerful for me, or Wednesday afternoon, I guess. On Wednesday, we were sent out in our groups to go around the community, and my group went to Lake Eola to pray over the people there. And during this prayer walk, my group went over to pray for this guy. And while my group was praying for this guy, a car pulled up next to him, and it was another woman seeking prayer. I just knew immediately that it was God calling me out to pray for her, because it was a prayer that I prayed in the van. It didn't really have too much heart behind it, but I knew that God was listening to it. So I went over and prayed for this woman, and I could just tell that it was really just like needed for her. I could see the faith inside of her, and that was just a really powerful experience for me. Another part of the summer that was really powerful for me was Brothers Retreat. During Brothers Retreat, I got the opportunity to lead a breakout group. And going into it, I didn't really know what it was. I didn't really know what I was going to talk about. But over time, I prayed about it. I read scriptures, and God just guided me. And he led me to talk on the topic of temptation. The reason he led me to speak about that topic is because that was a topic that I knew it spoke a lot with me and with my faith journey. So this whole time, I was writing about temptation. It was just an opportunity for me to grow closer to God. And one of the parts that I liked about it the most is not only did it help me grow in relationship with God, but I also got to share that with my brothers. I also got the chance to volunteer at two camps this summer. I got to volunteer at sixth grade camp and middle school camp. And during both these camps, I just love to go to these camps every year and volunteer, because I get to see the future of Epic and how just energetic and excited they are to learn more about God, whether it's through worship, through prayer, or just asking questions in small group. One of the verses from sixth grade camp stuck out with me, and that was Ephesians 6:13. That says, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you would be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." So this is actually one of my favorite verses that was brought back to my attention during this camp. And the reason why it stuck out to me is because for me, putting on the whole armor of God means that God is always with me. He will never leave my side, and whenever I need help fighting my battles, God will always be with me. Over the summer, I've grown so much closer to God through all the activities that I've done at Epic, and I just can't wait to see what he's going to do throughout the rest of this year.
Well, good morning. Always an honor to be with you. I do just want to point out, it's so incredible. We got young people up here brave enough to come up and speak. So thank you to all of you. Janet, I know we're not young, but we also got up here and spoke, so that's good. So I feel like after a summer, we should share a few counting stats just so you get an idea of the scope of what's going on. So I think food does a good job of representing that. I added up the number of pizzas that we ordered from Little Caesars this summer for camps, multiplied it by 8 pieces per pizza, and I came to 5,360 pieces of pizza. Wow. They know me by name at Little Caesars. I don't know if that's a friendly or not, but they know. We ate around 5,600 popsicles. So if your kids are looking extra fit and healthy, it's not because of us, but we did feed them and keep them energized. We had about 800 kids at our various children's ministry camps come through our doors, and hundreds of volunteers. And so if you are one of those people, thank you from the bottom of my heart for allowing us to do what we get to do. We can't do it without volunteers. I mentioned to Megan a couple weeks ago, I said, I've never seen a group of volunteers this incredible. And then like that same group came back the next week for another camp. I can't believe young people are willing to give up hours and hours and hours of their summer. So thank you to all of you that were a part of that. All right, I have a few photos for you today. This service is often a lot of sunshine and rainbows, as it should be, but I do need to show you. It's hard work, all right? So the first photo I have, this is Sean, who works. Yeah. He deserves it. This is Sean, who works in children's ministry. This is before camp started one morning, and then here is Sean after camp one day. He is so tired, he couldn't even make it into the air conditioning. He just laid down in the street. All right, so that is hard work, for sure. Couple other quick photos, and then we'll get moving. We do a wrapping paper fashion show. Andrew, you should look up. You're on the screen. Make things beautiful in here. The next picture, we had someone that goes to this church develop an escape room just out of the goodness of her heart so the kids could do that, and they loved it. They wouldn't stop talking to me about it. It's amazing. And then if you guys are sitting right over here, this happened right where you are. You're in, like, game-use territory. We did octopus tag. So that's Isla as an octopus chasing people around with pool noodles. Wild times. But I show you all these pictures to show you this picture. We love our kids and our families, and we love them because we've first been loved by a good God. And so everything we do, the crazy stuff and the not so crazy stuff, is to get to something like this where kids are leading other kids in worship. All we desire is for our kids and their families to know Jesus. And so that's where all the popsicles and mediocre pizza comes from, is to make sure they love being here and that this place feels like home so we can tell them why this place feels like home. So that's why we exist, and that's why we sweat and lay in the street because we're so tired and that kind of thing. It's for our families and our kids. So kids, we love you very much. All right, last thing. As I settled on a word to talk about today, the word that kept coming to me was faithfulness. Every summer I look back and I see how faithful God has been in our ministry. That had taken a bunch of goofballs, and somehow we are lucky enough to have that many kids come in our doors that we get to tell about Jesus. And one of the reasons that word came to me is because of my dear friend Megan. Many of you know. Yeah, you can cheer for Megan. I'm in on that. Many of you know, Megan is moving on to teach middle school, which, good luck. Middle schoolers are something else. But Megan has been working for me with me in some capacity for 8 years. It's a very long time. She's put up with me for 8 years. It's pretty incredible, honestly. And when I had a full-time job open up, it's the first person I called. Luckily, I only had to make one phone call. I don't like making phone calls. And the reason that faithfulness, I think, Megan exemplifies is that she knows what God's call is on her life, and she pushes forward in that in everything she does. If your kids have come in contact with Megan, they have been well-loved, not because it's her job, because it's who she is. They have been well-cared for. Megan will put anything on pause to help a kid who needs help, to love a kid who needs loved. And our children's ministry has been marked by that, and hopefully will continue to be marked by that, because that's the example we want to be. And so we're going to celebrate Megan after this service is over. This place will turn into a celebratory space for her as she moves on. And I hope you stay and linger and let her know how she has impacted your family's lives. But Megan is a dear friend and a dear coworker, and I am sad to see her go. I have to be honest. She knows that already, though. But I'm also, it's not just sadness, because I know there's a whole new group of kids and families that are going to receive that faithfulness of who Megan is and who she is in Christ that will be poured out in their lives day after day after day, even as they do ridiculous middle school things. And so, Megan, I would love for you to come up here, because we would like to pray for you as you go off. And if you would, please extend a hand to Megan as we pray for her. And then, Chris, you can hop right up here after that. Lord, we recognize that there is an immense amount of people in this room whose lives have been richly blessed by Megan. That what you have poured into her and who you have made her to be has allowed many of us to see your face, to encounter you, to see who you are. And so as she goes from this place, Lord, we are sad to see her go. We love her so much, but we are so excited to see what you have for her. We know the doors of Innovation Middle School are blessed because she is going to be walking into them every day. And so we pray for her year. We pray for when it's hard. We pray for when the kids are acting like middle schoolers. We pray for the whole thing. But most of all, Lord, we just pray that you will continue to show Megan who you are and that you have made her for exactly this time and place to pour into these kids and their families' lives. So thank you for her ministry here and her life and who she is. In Jesus' name, amen.
Up here, but if you know Megan, you have come in contact with a piece of God's heart for his people and specifically for kids. I've known Megan for, 10 plus years. It's been a while. And believe it or not, she had this much energy like 10 years ago too. But literally, like, I don't know if I know anyone who embodies like the resilient joy that we talk about here better than you do. And the amount of passion that you've poured into so many families here will far outlast your presence in the kids' ministry. And so just know for me, Megan, I'm so, so grateful for your time here. And we end our service every week saying church service has ended, but church is just beginning. Go and be the church. And so really, Megan's just continuing kids' ministry in the context of a school now, and the day-to-day interactions that teachers have with kids. And so that kind of transitions into what we want to do next. And we recognize that there's a lot of you in here who are starting off a new school year, coming up either this week or next week, and whether that be you are a student or maybe you are a teacher, you're an administrator, you're a professor, you are a bus driver, you are a crossing guard, you're a school counselor, like whatever it may be, you're about to get started with the year. And one of the things that we wanted to do today was actually to pray over all of you heading into this next time. There's something about celebration that is actually meant to kind of commingle into the realm of prayer. And that's what we kind of call like blessing prayer, that we actually just want to bless you as you head into this next time. And so, Chris, would